call this meeting to order and wait till we get a quorum before we can take any action. But we can start with Representative Sundin, or Sundin, House File 55.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee.
And I'll move the bill to put it before us, House File 55, to be passed and referred to taxes or property taxes.
Again, Mr. Chairman, House File 55 reinstates and makes permanent the Carlton County's authority to levy in and for the unorganized township of Sawyer for cemetery purposes. This eliminates the 1,000 annual cap on the levy, and this would require local approval. The special law was originally enacted in 1999 and expired 2009, and it would serve the county and that township and the cemetery well to adopt this.
Okay, are there any questions of the Representative Sundin?
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, it is Sundin.
Sundin, okay. Mr. Sundin, are there any questions of Mr. Sundin? Is there anybody that wishes to testify for or against the bill, or? One second here. Officially call to order. Now we have a quorum and proceed.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I'm Kent Sulem, General Counsel with the Minnesota Association of Townships. And we're not in any way opposed to this bill. As you and I had a quick conversation with Representative Sundin and Ms. Dyson, we simply are flagging an issue of drafting, and that is we believe when there's unorganized area, the proper terminology is unorganized territory, not unorganized township. And it's a semantical thing, but it's had some issues for us in other areas. And so, again, not at all opposed to the bill. And Ms. Bison, I know, is going to do a little research because of the specific name issue here, Sawyer, which is not a legal entity in and of itself. If it's an organized territory, it'd be one of our members. If it's unorganized, it's already part of the county, and the county would need this authority. But we just believe for drafting purposes that it may, as it proceeds down the road, need to be changed to territory instead of town to avoid confusion. And if you look in statute, there's about 43 references to territory versus township and 7 for unorganized town that we're trying to get them all revised for consistency. So I just flagged that for the record.
Thank you, Mr. Solem. Ms. Dyson here just said we could do it now, but I think we should wait to see, make sure we get it right if it affects other ones. So it has to go to property taxes, and even though we like to do things in our committee that we need to get done, this is something that just came up, and it can be taken care of there as well as here. So I will officially, again, now that we got a quorum, I'll officially move House File 55 to be passed and referred to property taxes. I get any questions? Representative Pepin.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and Representative Sundin. Just looking at the bill here, what you took out the before it said up to 1,000 annually, and I'm sorry, I kind of was disorganized when I walked in, but why is there not a number in there? So does this allow them to levy whatever they want, or is there any limit on it? Or
Mr. Chairman, that would allow the county to levy what's necessary to maintain that. We don't know on a year-to-year basis on exactly what that cost would be, but that leaves the authority up to the county.
Representative Pepin.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and Representative Sundin. So there's really no limit on what they could levy. There's no control over it. I'm just curious why you didn't want to put some control over how much they could levy.
Mr. Chairman, the control would not be in the purview of the state. You know, we're handing this responsibility over to the county and their discretion.
President Pepin.
Thanks. Well, maybe Ms. Dyson, is that, do we do that frequently?
Ms. Tyson.
And do we usually put levy, maybe you could kind of clarify how often we put a levy limit on and how often we just let them do whatever they want?
Mr. Chair and Representative Pepin, I don't have the information on the on any general law limits specific to cemeteries, but this is a special law just for Carlton County, and actually this was enacted originally in 99, and it actually, this identical bill passed the committee and was in the vetoed tax bill last year. So, but I don't have the an answer about other limits. Sometimes the legislature limits amounts for specific purposes, and sometimes it doesn't.
Representative Pepin?
That's fine, thank you.
Any other questions? Representative Ward?
Point of information. Just wondering when this is, when the language would need to be changed, who changes that? Do we need to say something about that? Or does that go somewhere else?
What would happen here is we could do the amendment here, but what the amendment would get drafted, and then in the next committee, Representative Sundin would probably bring that with him, and then somebody on that committee would have to, the property tax committee would have to make the motion. I sit on the property tax committee also, so, but it's normally we do that here in our, but because this is an issue that I was told just came up last night that they were, became aware of, that we want to make sure that we get the language right, so when it gets drafted, it's drafted properly. We don't want to do something on the fly here that changes it dramatically, and then we have to fix it later on. So
that's why I was asking. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Any other questions? Okay, all in favor of? Representative Bond, did you have a question?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Would the author indicate whether he is intending to have the language amendment drafted and ready for the next committee?
Representative Sundin.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, yeah, I just became aware of this minutes ago myself as far as the necessary changes, and would be acceptable to that, and it'll be ready, I understand, for the next committee hearing.
Representative Clark. Okay, whatever. Representative.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a quick question, and I apologize if we talked about this. Ms. Dyson was referring to the fact that this was included in the tax bill, and so it's good that we get a chance to kind of revisit these things since it didn't go into law. So the question that I have is, why is it that this county has this issue versus all of the other 86 counties that we have? And is this something that we're doing in special legislation, or is it just good public policy that we've rolled this back and put all counties on the same footing?
Ms. Dyson.
Mr. Chair and Representative O'Driscoll, it's not going to be an issue for all counties. There are 16 counties in the state with unorganized areas that don't have organized towns and cities. So in those 16 counties, whether or not there's a cemetery in the unorganized area of the county, that I don't know. So it apparently became an issue for Carlton County and this cemetery, but I don't have the information on the other 15 counties or even the other areas in Carlton County, whether there are cemeteries in the unorganized areas or not. There's a general law governing abandoned cemeteries. There is cemetery law, and I don't have an expertise in cemetery law and the limits on raising money for maintaining active and closed cemeteries and abandoned cemeteries. But so I don't have a good answer for you on whether or not this particular issue comes up over and over again. This is the only one I know of, but there may be others out there.
Representative Driscoll.
Yeah, and again, just asking from a policy standpoint, since we're dealing with the issue, does it make sense for us to look in a more global aspect or effect of the state versus just on a county by county basis? That's the purpose for the question, I guess. So thank you for your information, Stason.
Any other questions? Representative Ruskowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The question I have is what type of guidelines, given if this was adopted into law, what type of guidelines would the county have in terms of the amount that they would levy and the purposes for which they would spend ostensibly the money around a set, around a cemetery. Are there any guidelines? It appears we're creating a special law. I'm thinking about the taxpayers of the county here. Does anyone have any insight on that? Maybe the author does.
Representative Sundin.
Again, Mr. Chairman, county officials would be responsible to the voters and taxpayers in that county. And they do have a baseline to work off of 10 years ago, or back in 1999, excuse me. They set a number of $1,000, and I imagine the taxpayers would hold them to be responsible in their expenditures, maybe starting from that baseline and whatever is necessary. There's a couple generations of veterans buried in that cemetery, and I certainly want to do a good job and be respectful of the families in that community.
Representative Skalski.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Any further questions? Representative Freiberg.
I was just going to say, to follow up on Ms. Dyson's comments, I know it is in state law, if a cemetery becomes abandoned, if the cemetery association stops running it, it falls into the jurisdiction of the local unit of government it's located in. I know this because I was on the city council of Golden Valley for 9 years, and we have a cemetery that was abandoned there. At least in the case of the suburbs, it's running a cemetery is not part of the typical duties of the local government. I imagine that's the case in Carlton County as well, so it can lead to several unexpected costs that aren't budgeted for. I imagine that's what's going on here. Just a comment.
Okay. Perfect. Any further questions or comments? Otherwise, I renew my motion that House File 55 be passed and referred to property tax. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Ayes have it. Motion's passed. Thank you, sir.
I thank the committee and Mr. Chairman. Thank
you. And next on our agenda here is we have an overview from the Sports Facility Authority. I believe we have a video going with it too, so. Proceed then, if everything's ready.
Okay, great. My name's Michelle Kelm-Helgen, and I'm chair of the Minnesota Facilities Stadium Authority. I really appreciate the opportunity to see you today and give you an overview of where we're at on the stadium as far as the authority is concerned, as well as where we are on the overall project. I anticipate that this could be the first of a number of presentations for such a big project. I know accountability and transparency are really important, so I'm available at any time. We're passing out just a couple of documents that I'll refer to later in my presentation, and then a few other things perhaps at the end. As you all know, in May 2012, you, the legislature, approved a bill to build a new stadium. The governor signed the bill. This was clearly a bipartisan effort that took place and probably over 10 years in the making. As you know, the state of Minnesota, along with the city of Minneapolis, contributed $498 million to the project. The Vikings, the team, put in $477 million for a total of $975 million for the construction of a new stadium in Minneapolis. The Minnesota Sports Facilities Authority was an organization that was created in the legislation to build, own, and operate the new People's Stadium. It also, however, took over as of August the current assets and operations of the existing Minnesota Facilities Commission that essentially was moved out of existence and replaced with the new authority, and essentially all their assets and the business of the commission was transferred to the authority. So we also at this point operate the current Metrodome as well as building the new stadium, and obviously we'll be involved in operation of that as well. The authority is made up of 5 members. I'm the chair. 2 other members, and I was appointed by Governor Dayton. 2 other members appointed by Governor Dayton include John Griffith, who's the Executive Vice President of Real Estate Development for Target Corporation, as well as Dwayne Benson, who serves as a trustee for Minsky, as well as many of you know him as a former Republican legislator. Barbara Butts-Williams is Dean of Education at Capella University. She was appointed by the mayor, along with Bill McCarthy, who's president of the Minneapolis Regional Labor Federation. Both Mr. McCarthy and Ms. Butts-Williams was appointed by Mayor Rybeck. New stadium, again, most of you know this, I'll be quick about it. It's going to be located on the current Metrodome site, which is 33 acres. It'll have a large plaza that opens to the city. It'll be right around 1.5 to 1.6 million square feet. I want to just put this in terms. The current Metrodome is 975 square feet, and this 1.5 is, again, a third bigger than what currently is operating. So it will essentially have the same number of seats, 65,000 seats, but it'll be almost a third again as large. So the public spaces in particular will be much larger. Hallways, anyone who's been to the Metrodome in the last years, I think, can attest to the fact that it's almost a safety issue over there as people try to move around in those crowded hallways and narrow public spaces. The facility will be set up to accommodate 65,000 seats, as I mentioned, similar to the current Metrodome, but it will be expandable to up to 73,000 square feet, 73,000 seats, which is required to accommodate a Super Bowl. It will have major technology advances throughout the stadium, as well as we are looking at the architect that we have chosen has developed sustainable architecture that has gotten LEED certification, and we're looking to do something similar in the stadium. Obviously, a good number of public spaces. The team is talking about putting together a team store inside the Metrodome, inside the new stadium, as well as a football Hall of Fame store as well. There could also be a restaurant that would be open to the, not only inside the stadium, but could be open to the outside. There's space identified for that, but it's unclear as to whether that actually will end up being part of the program. The usage, I think everybody is familiar with, the Vikings obviously play 10 home games a year, including preseason. But the other 355 days are used for other programming. We do over 300 baseball games in the Metrodome every year, and the baseball program will obviously be a big component of what the authority offers. They're talking about there's, within the legislation, there's the option for the team to bring in an MLS, a professional soccer team, but there's currently a lot of soccer games, state soccer tournaments are played in the Metrodome. The opening game for the Minnesota Stars is always played in the Metrodome. There's marching band competitions. There's many community events. We just had Hmong New Year about a month ago that was hosted at the Metrodome. A lot of dirt events. Monster trucks were held there again last Saturday. There's some motocross races coming up. There just are a lot of public events and community events that are held at the Metrodome. And while clearly the majority of the revenue comes from the NFL Viking football team, the number of events that we host there, it really becomes almost a statewide park in a sense for indoor venues that need to be held around the state. At the time that the roof went down, I think that's when people realized a couple years ago what an important asset this enclosed dome has become for the overall community events that are held in the state. So we as the authority look to accommodate all that. This is just a map that shows kind of the orientation of the stadium. A lot of people have talked about the location and asked us, why is this going to be any different than the current Metrodome? What are you going to do differently to make sure that the current Metrodome sort of sits as an island and kind of isolated from the rest of the city and the neighborhoods? We're going to be putting a big public plaza in the front of the stadium. There's going to be connections to, our architect talks about the fact that there really won't be a front door. There's going to be doors that open that lead to, with bike paths and trails and sidewalks, to the riverfront as well as to the Elliott Park neighborhood. And obviously the lead-in to the city downtown core is very essential. I think the big difference is with light rail transit, and granted it's been there for a good number of years, but I think the whole question that surrounded what's going to happen with the development on that site has really kept a lot of business and industry and residential developers from making decisions to put any kind of investment there, given the fact it's been so unclear as to what was going to happen with that Metrodome and that big site. Now that it's been identified, I think everyone is probably, there's a lot of interest and activity happening with developers already around that area, given the fact that they now know what is going to be located in that spot. We realize that a big part of our job is to make sure that we connect with the rest of the city, and the overall economic impact of the state's public investment is leveraged in a lot of ways. The architect that we've chosen has developed Cowboys Stadium in Dallas, and they've also developed the stadium in Indianapolis. I think it's really key to think about the fact that our architect has been able to, obviously these two stadiums are very different in look and appearance, and the work that they're doing so far indicates that yet again the work that will be done in Minneapolis will make it very specific to our city and that site and our state and take on its own look. Part of what we were interested in is the architect, HKS, has a lot of experience working in urban environments and really taking the design and tailoring it to meet the needs of the city that it's located in. This was just one possible rendering that HKS did when they made their proposal. That's not to say that the stadium that will be coming out and shown to the public here in the next 6 weeks or so is going to look anything like this. But it's a good indication of the type of work they can do and the creativity that they have. We selected HKS as our architect in September 2012. As part of that architect selection, for the first time, even though it was not required by legislation, the authority and the team agreed that they would have the architect commit to do a package that would have targeted women and minority businesses. We set a goal for those architects to include in their subcontracts 11% women-owned businesses and 9% minority-owned businesses. We have an equity plan of which we passed around, and I'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. But essentially, our architects, we announced 19 sub-consultants that were hired, a good many that were women and minority-owned firms. And essentially, our architect is definitely on track to meet these goals. This in a professional services contract for a big project like this is really the first time this was done. And we see this as a major focus, benefit, and requirement for our project. So we're very glad that our architect has been on board to meet these goals. The Stadium Authority will adopt the City of Minneapolis workforce goals, which essentially call for the workforce for the construction portion of the project to be include 32% minority folks and 6% women. This is considerably higher than any other public projects have been before. The Target Field project had a goal of 26% minority workforce and 6% women. They did meet those goals, but again, this project is going to be quite a bit higher. We're putting, we'll talk just briefly about it in a minute, but we're putting together an equity plan that will help us achieve those goals. In December of 2012, actually, an RFP was issued for a construction manager. The selection will occur actually within the next week and a half. We've got proposals that have been submitted by three firms. They have included proposals to be the construction manager from Mortensen, Hunt Construction, and Skanska Construction. We're going to be interviewing those firms starting tomorrow and then have a whole vetting process that take place. This is definitely one of those, the way the legislation is written. All the key decision-making points in this project must be approved by the authority as well as the team. So this was true with the selection of the architect. We put in place a very focused process that we worked through for the selection of the architect to bring both the team and the authority in agreement to conclude the selection of the architect. We're doing the same thing for the construction manager. So it's a joint decision that has to be made, and it's a process to get us there that's already in place. We should have an announcement. We'll call a special board meeting to announce the selection or to vote on the selection of the construction firm, and that will be sometime between February 1st to February 8th, so coming up that first week in February. And I just mentioned here basically that process. The equity plan we unveiled at our board meeting last Friday, and essentially what it did was we put out a draft, because this equity plan eventually has to become part of the contract that's signed with the construction firm. We want to make sure the construction firm weighs in to agree to whatever that plan is that's put in place, because obviously the construction manager is going to be the key player in making sure we meet these goals. So we put it out as a draft. The construction firms will review it and give us their feedback. We also wanted the community to have an opportunity to take a look at our draft plan, as well as any of you, to be able to respond to this. In the city of Minneapolis, we've distributed it quite widely. It's available in detail on our website, and we've passed out copies for all of you. I emphasize it's a draft, so if there are things that you are concerned about or want to weigh in on, let us know. It essentially is the roadmap that we're going to use to achieve the very aggressive goals that the city of Minneapolis has set as targets for this project. There's quite a bit of accountability. There'll be a review panel that will be put together with outside folks as well as the authority and the team, to talk with all of the three candidates who have put in proposals to be construction manager, to make sure we look at what their workforce goals and requirements and achievements have been on prior projects. We'll have that conversation with all of them. And then there'll be an ongoing oversight committee that will meet on a monthly basis with our contractor, as well as all the subcontractors that are involved in the project. So we have periodic meetings to review where they're at and have them make reports. Again, I emphasize periodic meetings, because to start with, obviously, we don't break ground for quite a while. So while the committee will start meeting and talking with the construction firm, it'll ebb and flow as to when reports have to be made. So we will just have periodic meetings to review all this. We look at the transparency again for our project to be really important, which is why we put out a draft plan. There'll be a meeting that involves labor, the community, and many different stakeholders on January 24th, which is, I guess, Thursday of this week, to actually talk about the plan in more detail and to get feedback. And we had this group made up of of labor and many different community stakeholders, training organizations, who looked at what would be needed in the plan. Now that we've got the plan out in draft, we want to kind of go back to that same group. So that meeting will be held on the 24th. We expect to finalize this equity plan whenever we have the board meeting to select the contractor, because as I mentioned, the equity plan will become part of the construction manager's contract. So early February, we will select the construction manager, have our equity plan done. In March, we will have the schematic design for the new stadium done. So that'll be a big step. People can actually then see the design that is going to be for the stadium that's going to be built, and that'll be done sometime in March. And then the other big time frame is sometime in the fall, right around the October time period, we'll break ground for the new stadium. We get a lot of questions about, you know, how long they're going to have to play at TCF. I know originally when they were here back last session talking about the construction in the new stadium, they talked about the fact that there was going to be every attempt made to try to limit the time played at TCF Stadium to 1 year, 2015. We always knew that the 2012 season, which we just completed, the 2013 season, which is the one coming up, would be played at the Metrodome. The question has always been what happens in 2014. In fact, what would have to happen is we would have to be essentially building around the construction of the new dome, of the new stadium, while we keep the old stadium up for almost a year. We've got the architect is there doing their drawings and looking at the new site plan and how it's going to be done, as well as the construction manager. When they get on board, they'll give us a recommendation here in the next month, and then we will make a decision as to what happens. I will tell you, however, it is looking more and more likely, just based on conversations and initial feedback we've had with the architect, that they will have to play 2 years at TCF Stadium. There's quite a cost and there's quite a risk and a liability to try to build around an existing stadium. I think everyone knew that to try to limit the time at TCF would be important, but when you balance that with the other factors, it just may not be possible. But we will have something. At this point, we're not making that final decision until we get a recommendation specifically from both the architect as well as the construction manager once they're on board. There's a legislative report that I passed around. As part of the new legislation that was passed, we have a report that's due every year to the chairs of the State Government Finance Committee, as well as, I assume, that new Legislative Oversight Committee that is being formed. The new Legislative Oversight Committee essentially is being formed by both with appointees from both caucuses. There are six House members, three from the Democratic caucus and three from the House caucus, and a similar number from the Senate caucus. They have overall oversight responsibility, and I assume that will be coming and making periodic reports to that committee as well. The things that they asked us to look at, and again, this is all in this report that I gave you, they asked us to recommend any increase in the rate or dollar amount of taxes, and we are not making any recommendations for increases. Any increase in the debt of the authority, and we're not asking for that either. And they asked us to share our operating budget and capital budget with you. And the operating budget that was approved by the board is included in that. Obviously, the things that I think they'll be most interested in will be the budgets for the new stadium, which clearly aren't done yet, as the new stadium is just in process. And they asked about our preliminary capital budgets. Clearly, we're not doing a lot of capital improvements in the Metrodome, given the fact it'll be coming down here in a short amount of time. But there clearly will be a significant capital budget that's put aside and reserved for the new stadium. But that also is in process, and we'll have more information about that for you at a later date. these were just the four items that were requested in that legislative oversight report. We have, as I mentioned, a collaborative decision-making process with the team, which is required by the legislation. Keeping on schedule is obviously going to be the way that we keep on budget. And in order to keep on schedule, we need to have a collaborative decision-making process that lets us represent the public interest, the team represent their interests, and come to decisions that we can all live with. So we are definitely working hard to have a good process in place, and so far we've been very successful in doing that. Everything we do, we feel like has to be done in a very open and transparent process. There clearly is a significant amount of public money in this project, and I know there are a lot of people who are really interested in what we're doing. We've already had a lot of public outreach and input. I look at that as being a big part of my job and that of the authority. We've done public listening sessions around the state. We had one in Rochester, Duluth, and a suburban location in the city of Minneapolis to get input on what should, as we look at, we took our architect with us. What do we need to make sure we don't miss when we're designing the new stadium? In fact, we had people who showed up from kind of every area, a lot of college sporting events that currently use the Metrodome, marching band folks, many community people who all came and talked about very specific things that they were concerned about, that they either want replicated from the Metrodome to the new stadium, or things that they'd like to be done differently. We know that we need to continue with this public dialogue, and we need to be really open about what's happening. So once we get our new design, our plan is to continue these public meetings and go around the state and talk with people about what the new stadium is going to look like, how it's going to operate, and what kind of an asset it can be to all people of Minnesota. We're doing a lot of work, obviously, with the surrounding business and neighborhood groups that are located right around the stadium to make sure that we're making the kind of integration that's necessary to make sure that we've got a much bigger leveraged economic impact from this new investment that the state is making. The city of Minneapolis has put together a very detailed process of an implementation committee that we work with, report to, collaborate with, which has been a good way to make sure that we stay on track with the city. That's it for my presentation. As I mentioned, I gave you a copy of the equity plan, and I gave you a copy of the legislative report that we put together. The only other thing that I did want to address, I've had a question from a number of legislators about another piece that's been in the legislation that calls for a raffle to be put together. And I know people have been interested and perhaps concerned about how we address this. The statute called for the fact that it said, and I quote, "The authority shall study the feasibility of conducting a raffle for chances to win a pair or other limited numbers of prime seats in the stadium for professional football games, must consult with the NFL team." And it says, if the authority determines conducting the raffle is financially feasible, we must cooperate with the Director of Gambling Control Board to do this. So essentially, I've got copies here, just so you have some background. We approached this from the standpoint that we first received a letter from the head of the Gambling Control Board, which I will share with you, that essentially said that he believes, given the limits that are in current law, he did not think that he had three significant areas of concern related to the potential feasibility for this raffle. And essentially, the way we looked at it, it seemed like, given the legal hurdles, the financial limitations, that it was, in our estimation, perhaps not feasible. We had our attorneys for the authority take a look at it from Dorsey, and they concluded that it was not feasible for legal reasons. I have heard from a number of legislators who have had your staff take a look at this, and I would agree that certainly reasonable people can disagree about how you interpret this. And essentially what we've been told is they are concerned that while the authority looked at this, determined it not to be feasible, primarily based on legal reasons, and then the limitations that Tom Barrett told us about related to the financial pieces of conducting a lottery, they still believe that we really did not look at what the legislation asked for in terms of financial feasibility. So my approach is definitely, if the legislature sees fit, I think our attorneys are pretty clear that they think, and Tom Barrett has told us as well, but I think our attorneys are saying, if you really want to do this, there would be changes in law that would have to be made in order to accommodate the authority to be able to conduct a raffle and collect the proceeds and that kind of thing. But if the legislature decides that they, in fact, do want to make those changes in law, we definitely would look, do a financial analysis that would be in addition to the legal analysis that we had done. So I will say I think reasonable people can debate what is in fact considered to be feasible. I guess we looked at feasibility from, you know, if it's not possible to do, it probably isn't feasible. But I understand there are others that want us to go a step further and look at the financial piece as well.
I have a couple people on the list here. Representative Pepin, do you have a question?
I do have a question. Is Representative Winkler on the list first?
He's on the list also.
Yeah, I'm on the list. I'm on a couple lists.
Well, perhaps I'll pass until after Representative Winkler. I might have a follow-up question. Oh, okay. Well, does she have this? I mean, I guess I'm disappointed because the language clearly says financially feasible, and I feel like there's a little bit of a runaround here. I don't think the legislative intent was fairly clear, and I just have to say I'm very disappointed that you decided to just look at significant legal barriers and not actually look to see if there was the financial feasibility, which was, you know, you say that there's reasonable minds can differ, but financially feasible is very different than legally feasible. And so I just have a comment, I guess, saying that I'm disappointed and that you didn't look at it the way that it was, the legislative intent was. And I hope you will go back and do as the intent was and look at a financial study.
Ms. Helgen?
Mm-hmm. The Chair, Representative Pepin, the only thing I would say is if you look at Tom Barrett's analysis, he does pose some financial issues and concerns as well. So I do, and again, I understand you can interpret that differently, but our counsel did point out that the way it reads, it first starts out with a general feasibility statement, and then it does talk about the financial feasibility. So again, it's early, it's only been a couple of months. I will say from an authority standpoint, we obviously can, if you direct us to look at this in a broader way, we certainly will. But just so you understand, we were not intentionally ignoring the legislative intent. We did believe, given the Gambling Control Board's financial questions and concerns, and then whether in fact it was legal from a feasibility standpoint, those two pieces is where we came to our conclusions. But we will certainly go back and look at it from a broader standpoint. So I have no problem with that. I've got the memo that was done by your research department. And I can make sure that we follow up on that as well.
Representative Pepin.
Please do, because I believe that's what you're supposed to do in the first place. So I think that would be appropriate. Thanks.
Representative Winkler.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thanks, I guess I can't call you Michelle, Ms. Helgen, for coming and for sharing the information on the raffle. You know, I'm a little bit confused because I've seen two different letters from the Gambling Control Board on this topic. The first letter from Mr. Barrett contained a short summary of some of the limitations potentially on conducting a raffle. This is much, the letter that you handed out is much longer. And Mr. Barrett was also, I can't remember which, was quoted in a TV news story about this, saying that this could potentially, this raffle could potentially be a big money maker. So, you know, there are a lot of questions I have about, you know, why there are so many statements from the Gambling Control Board about this. But one of the basic questions I have is whether, I don't know if anybody here can speak for the Vikings, but what the Vikings' position on this has been. I have heard that they don't like the idea of a ticket raffle, but I don't know if there's anybody here that can speak to that question. Because it seems to me that if we find out if this is financially feasible and would make money, that's one important point. The other point is, you know, if this is a people's stadium, it seems to me fans would like a chance to get some good tickets by putting in a little bit of money for a raffle. It just seems like this is something that a lot of people would be really happy to have a chance to do, to get a chance at seats and tickets they would never otherwise really be able to afford. So it seems like that would be kind of a good public relations thing for the Vikings. It seems like it would be a good kind of feather in the cap of this people's stadium, that people could actually get some of the best seats. So I wonder if the Vikings have anybody here who could address that.
That's a question from the audience. Is there anybody here from the Vikings that would like to come down and speak to this, or?
Spade is not here today, and I think he'd have to be better spoken, better dealt with by him than either Ms. Cook or myself were. I apologize, Mr. Chair, but we're just not up and up on the issues of the village.
As I guess the question is answered, that it's no, not today.
No, not today. And, you know, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, and Ms. Helgen, you know, certainly the Vikings have been well represented at the legislature in the last year and a half. This language was originally included in the bill as an amendment on the House floor. The bill was passed, it went to conference committee, it came back, it was repassed, signed into law. I've never heard a word from the Vikings about it. Again, I've heard that they're opposed to it, but I haven't heard from them. Then last summer, it was one of the last meetings of the old Sports Facilities Commission. This raffle was on their agenda. Mr. Bagley was in the audience, along with a number of other representatives from the Vikings. Again, had an opportunity to speak in opposition to this raffle and didn't do so. And so it seems to me that the language in this memo is relatively strong. It's from Mr. Michael, and I think Joel Michael is highly regarded by all members of the Minnesota House, and I think probably the Senate. It seems like the language is pretty strong. I don't understand what the opposition really is to doing this raffle. I hear that it comes from the Vikings, but so far the Vikings haven't been willing to come forward with the courtesy of explaining their strong opposition to me anyway. And my only point is, I believe the legislation clearly requires a financial feasibility study of this. It seems like it's good for fans. It seems like it's consistent with the purpose of a people's stadium. And if there's some good reason why we shouldn't do it, I'd like to know what that is. Because, you know, I think Mr. Michael's memo is pretty spot on. The legislature knows how to conduct legal analysis. We're not so good at financial analysis, and that was the purpose of the amendment. So I hope we'll have an ongoing discussion about this. And hopefully the Vikings will decide that they want to be part of this discussion rather than opposing this behind the scenes.
Well,
Representative, or Ms. Helgen, do you want to comment?
Yeah. Chair, Representative Winkler, the only thing I do want to say is we really, as an authority and the team, and it does say we should consult with the NFL team, and given the barriers that we saw, again, which I understand you disagree with, but given the barriers that you saw, it never became a lengthy point of discussion as to whether it was something that should or could be done. So just from that standpoint, I can't speak for the team, but I can tell you in the spirit of the work that we've done together, it seemed like, I mean, they definitely agreed with us, and I do know that there was some discussion during negotiations that went on where concerns were expressed about NFL not wanting to be directly involved in the gambling area of doing raffles, that kind of thing. But again, I don't speak for the team. I just remember, not in my role as chair, but in my role over at the Capitol when I was in the governor's office, that there was a concern expressed by that. And that's all I would say related to it. So I can't speak for the team, but I do know that there has been some concern that was expressed primarily by the NFL when we were looking at that. But
Ms. Helgen, I have a question that has come up and been in the news and actually was hit with this weekend when I was at an event. Having to do with the shortfall that's been in the news about the gambling revenues, and where are we at with that, and what insight can you give us on that?
Mr. Chair, as you know, we're not directly involved in that piece of it, but given the fact that the gambling revenues are the primary source that are going to be used to pay off the bonds, we certainly have been watching the numbers and looking at what's coming in and following it. As I understand it, the revenues that are coming in, the big concern is just the saturation in terms of getting the machines out there into these locations as quickly as what had been forecasted. And the number of machines that are out there clearly is behind from what was originally recommended. I know there is a plan both from the Gambling Control Board as well as the charitable organizations and the bars to try to expand it pretty significantly. The good news is, also as I understand it, the bonds aren't going to be sold until later this year in the spring, and so the bond payments don't begin until 2014. This year was essentially the reserve year that is being looked at as far as collecting enough money ahead of time to have a cushion. So while there definitely is money going into the reserve from what that baseline was, it clearly, because of the slow start, is not as high as what had been originally forecast. But we are just talking about a matter of reserve. The other thing that I'm told is, and that I do remember from my involvement back at the time the legislation was passed, the coverage for the payment of those bonds is significantly higher than what's required to actually pay off the bonds. So even on an ongoing basis, if the proceeds are lower, there still is additional coverage that should give the state some wiggle room, some comfort in the payment of the bonds. That's not to say that it shouldn't be followed closely, and as I understand just from news accounts and, you know, from talking to people, I know Department of Revenue is following this very carefully and will be making periodic reports, but at this point it seems like it's probably too early to tell what the issues might be, could be, are at this time.
Thank you. Representative Kwan.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Looking at the documentation, I'm a little bit concerned when the budget is spending 112% of revenue and you're talking about reserves being lower than they were anticipated. I know that the state is fronting the first few years of Minneapolis's portion of covering the cost. I just believe we might have to revisit the streams on here. Does the testifier have any confidence she can give, especially since you're exceeding revenue, or, you know, your budget is above revenue? Are you planning to have no revenue left out of the existing funds and transition in, or would there at least be some cushion? And then following up with that, who's writing the check? So the checks are going to come from the state of Minnesota. Is there a fund that the NFL and the team are putting into, so there's a reserve account where it's going to be drawn out, or is the state just writing all the upfront checks?
Ms. Hill. Ms. Kelman.
Yeah. Mr. Chair, Representative Quam. There's a couple different, part of the challenge in the report that we made to the Legislative Oversight Commission is the fact that we're kind of operating on two fronts. One is the existing authority that is operating the current Metrodome, and that basically is the budget that you're looking at. And essentially what we're doing is, for this year and the following season, we're operating in the Metrodome, and we need to have money to cover those costs. There is and will be a whole separate project budget for the construction of the stadium, which really has nothing to do with our operational costs at the authority and our staff. The project budget that's being put together is what the bonding, the $975 million will cover. And the way the legislation is written, the team essentially puts in the first $50 million, and they upfront that, and that essentially is the money that we're, you know, they put this in an escrow account. And then that's the money we draw down on until the bonds are sold by the state and we start getting the proceeds from those bonds into the authority. So initially, we essentially are using the team's money to pay the bills, our architects, as we hire the construction manager. But all the checks right now, the money that the team puts in and the money the state puts in, is all done through the authority and the authority's budget. We write all the checks. The legislative auditor will, I'm sure, every year they do an examination of the authority, what had been the commission, now will be the authority's budget, as well as now as the project gets underway, the overall construction budget will be under the same scrutiny. So that will all be available. We'll be making regular reports. So I hope I'm answering your question. Essentially, the initial money that will be spent will come from the team. And then once the bonds are sold, that money will come into the project as well. But the money will all come out of the authority's checkbook, in a sense, if you will. But the money will come to us in pieces. It won't all be there at once. MMB will control all of that and put together, we don't have, because they haven't put together the bonding package yet. It'll come to us through what's called a grant agreement, and it'll specify all the terms of how the money comes and how it flows and that kind of thing.
Representative Quam.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I still have a little queasiness in that the authority that's handling it is spending in their budget more money than they have revenue coming in. And I guess I didn't understand why they're exceeding revenue already.
Representative Skowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and Ms. Kelm-Helgen. Do we know how the Vikings are financing their portion of the stadium deal? Do they have to borrow like the taxpayers of Minnesota do, or are they simply financing it off of their projected revenues over the life of the stadium?
Mr. Chair, Representative Droszkowski, I hesitate to speak for the Vikings. I know that they are working on a financial plan for that portion of the money. Some of it is coming, and this again was talked about during the legislative session. Some of it is coming from the NFL, and some of it is coming from the team, from various sources of revenue. So I would hesitate. They need to, the legislation is very clear that when they have their financial plan together, that the authority must review and approve from both a legal and financial process that the money is there and the funds are available as needed throughout the project. So we will be doing that oversight, but that is not done yet. Their financial plan is not completed yet, but it is in process. Again, I don't want to speak for them.
Representative Skowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, I was trying to remember all the elements of this $975 million, and I remember from the debate that it was projected to cost the taxpayers over the 20 or 30 years of the bonds $1.2 billion, if I remember correctly. What do you remember, or what is going to be the cost to the taxpayers over the life of these bonds, the taxpayers of Minnesota, including the Minneapolis taxpayers?
Ms. Elkin.
Mr. Chair, Representative Drazkowski, I have to tell you, I would have to say you should direct that question to MMB. I do also remember some of those discussions during the legislative session, but I have not had any specific discussions about that since, and I'm not sure that I recall the exact numbers. Part of it, a lot of it depends on the terms that are put together for the bonds, which are not done yet because they haven't done the bond sale. Depends on the interest rate, it depends on the number of years that the bonds are let and how they're repaid and that kind of thing. So I'm not sure until they put together the exact terms and the grant agreement that anybody could answer that specific question. But it will be covered. I mean, I think that will all be apparent when the grant agreement is done and the MMB has the bond sales that are let.
Representative Drazkowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thanks, Ms. Helgen. Good answer, an accurate answer. Thank you. The financing scheme, if you will, and I think many of us refer to this as a scheme, and we're seeing the fallout of this. The poll tabs are not producing $16 million so far out of the $34 million that was forecast or something. To this point, I do remember the discussion that it would have taken three times the amount of gross revenue currently produced by the pull tabs throughout Minnesota in order to cash flow this thing over time. So I'm interested to see those numbers. And I would ask, Mr. Chair, if we could at some point hear from either MMB and or revenue or maybe the Gambling Control Board or maybe all three of them and how these fit together so we can actually get our hands on those numbers. But my question would be, Ms. Helm-Kelvin, how do we fill the gap if they fall short? What is the plans? Are the Vikings going to pay the remainder if the state's portion falls short?
The legislation, Mr. Chair, Representative Drazkowski, the legislation does have a list of backup revenues. I have to be honest, I don't have it in front of me, but they've got like five or six backup revenue pieces that were identified to fill in gaps, and those would be the backup revenues that would be used. I know one of them was a tax on suites. There were four or five things that would be used.
Representative Drazkowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. What those backup revenues, do we know, would the Vikings be among those, or are the taxpayers going to again be asked to pay in that list? Do we remember, are the Vikings in the list?
Well, they are on the list indirectly in that the sweep tax would obviously affect the amount of money that the Vikings would have. So there are things indirectly, but again, there is a specific list, and I'm not recalling exactly what it is. I apologize. I can certainly find that, but it was four or five specific things.
Representative Skalski.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And last question, Ms. Helgen. The labor agreement plan, and we see this in other places in government where we carve out special efforts to hire people of specific traits, characteristics, qualities, or whatever you may want to describe them as these efforts. But what we often see happen is we see businesses who could do the job either better or at a lower cost discriminated against in the process. And so I'm wondering, this really a socially engineered workforce plan, what additional premium are the taxpayers of Minnesota going to have the opportunity to pay for given this approach compared to a normal market-oriented plan that brings forward the best product for the best price?
Ms. Elgin.
Mr. Chair, Representative Drazkowski, the workforce goals and targeted business goals are specifically set out in statute. The legislature included those things in the legislation and required us to do two things. Specifically, follow the workforce goals that are laid out by the city of Minneapolis, as well as the targeted business goals. So I just want to tell you, it's not something that we have a choice in, so that's part of the legislation and part of the intent, I believe. It also includes broader than just women and minorities. It includes some zip code qualifications in terms of poverty areas that people should come from. It's very specific. I will tell you, if you talk to the construction firms and the subcontracting firms that were involved in the Twins ballpark, as well as TCF Stadium, but Twins ballpark is probably the most recent example of a very large public project that did this. They don't believe they paid premiums for anything. I mean, I look at our architects and the work that was done for the subcontracts with the architects, and we had, as I mentioned, specific targeted business goals. Those subcontracts had to be signed off by both the authority and the team. And as they looked at it, the bids that came in from those firms were totally competitive financially. So I'm not sure how you would quantify that, and I'm not sure how you quantify it with workforce. You know, there will be prevailing wage that's paid on these projects, and regardless of where people come from, you know, the wage rate that's paid will be the same. So there won't be any premiums that way. I do think that there are some training costs that will be part of this. I suppose you could look at that and what will have to be paid for training to be done to make sure. But overall, when you look at the numbers of people that are going to be required to work on this project, the current workforce and sort of the numbers on the bench, if you will, the number of people that are trained in some of these, especially the highly skilled areas, and the number of projects that are going on, we're going to need to do some additional recruitment and training anyway, regardless of targets for, you know, ethnicity or gender, anything like that. You're going to have to be doing some recruitment and training. The numbers that we're looking at are really high compared to some of the workforce that's currently available. The other thing I think that's really a focus for us is to make sure that both for the firms as well as the workforce, that it's Minnesota people and companies, just bringing in workforce that may be trained from North Dakota, South Dakota, other places, is not really the intention, I believe, of the legislature or the team in the authority. I mean, I think people see the economic impact as being, you know, folks from Minnesota. So I believe that, you know, all these things kind of come together and work in a positive way, and the training that's going to have to be done probably has to be done anyway. Looking at the workforce, you look at the Department of Human Rights and the census data that they have. Clearly, our workforce balance is changing, just given the change in census data that the state and especially the seven county area is looking at. So as we talk to people both in union companies and non-union companies, I think they believe that the diversity of the population that's happening is going to have to be reflected in the workforce if we're going to have qualified workers to do the job. So I don't really see premiums per se being paid. And I do think it's important to look at the work that's been done in other projects really successfully. And still they've been able to meet their budget and stay on budget and schedule and that kind of thing. That's our intention.
Thank you, Ms. Elgin. We've got another presentation we have to do here, so I've got two more people on the line with Mr. Drakowski. So, Representative Drakowski, quickly.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll pass.
Representative Pepin.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Ms. Helgen, we've touched on this a little bit, but I'm still not really satisfied with the answer. I think Representative Nelson hit on it a little bit, and Representative Raskowski, and I'm concerned about the article that I read that talked about the electronic pull tabs and how they're far under projections, which isn't a surprise to many of us who assumed that that would happen because we didn't believe that the numbers were there based on the facts we were looking at. But be that as it may, it passed, and you know, there's a shortfall, and so you said that there were four or five backup taxes, and that's not my recollection, and I'm wondering if Ms. Dyson has a list of the backup taxes that were listed, because I think we only ended up with a couple, and if memory serves me, I think the convention center tax and the Minneapolis, or the twin sales tax was pulled out at one point. I guess the reason I'm wondering, and I'll let Ms. Dyson look at that, but I don't believe that there were four or five backup taxes. I think the backup taxes were very shaky to start with, and now I'm even more concerned now that what we thought might happen has indeed proven to be true, and I want to know what's going to happen. I want to know if who's going to be on the hook. If the backup plan doesn't happen, if the taxes don't make it, the backup taxes don't make it, are we going to be on the hook? Is this, we're going to have to pay for this from the general fund?
I think Representative Pepin, I think Mr. McCormick is here. I think he has full knowledge of that, so... Mr. McCormick.
Mr. Chair, members, Patrick McCormick from House Research. There are currently two backups in the legislation as passed. The first is a luxury tax or a tax on luxury suites, and that would kick in and probably raise somewhere in the $2 to $3 million per year range. And the second is the creation of a Vikings or sports themed lottery game, which could raise $1 million or $2 million per year. The way the bill is structured, the Commissioner of Minnesota Management and Budget would trigger these when he made a determination that there would not be sufficient funds to cover the projected needs of the bonds. And the second thing to note is that the bonds as put together in the bill are appropriation bonds. And if the appropriation bonds are validated by the Supreme Court, which is not necessarily going to happen, but that we think it's probable based on the court ruling on the tobacco bond case, if those bonds are validated by the Supreme Court and sold, then the bonds would be paid by the general fund, which would be reimbursed by pull tab revenues, potentially by the other two backup sources. If they were not sufficient, the three sources combined together were not sufficient, then the general fund would pay the appropriation bonds.
That's your question, Representative Pepin.
So, Mr. Chair and Ms. Helgen, so do you acknowledge then that this additional $4 million is likely going to result in this money being paid through the general fund?
Ms. Helgen.
Mr. Chair, Representative Pepin, I certainly couldn't answer that question. I don't, at this point, I don't have any reason to believe that would happen, but I'm not the expert in that. It would have to come from Department of Revenue, I would say, would be a better person to ask.
Representative Pepin.
Mr. Chair, thank you, and I think that was the concern that we had. It looks like it likely will have to come from the general fund unless things change. I want to go back a little bit on some of the issue that Representative Draskowski was talking about on the minority the minority bids, which I think it's good to have the minority bids, but you talked about doing it this way because it's required to follow under the workforce goals, which I thought it said 20% up here, and then the article that I read in the January 19th article in the Star Tribune said that of the 19 firms that won bids, only two of them were not minority owned. So two of the 19, so 17 of the 19 of these bids were minority owned. And I just was wondering if you could comment on that, because that seems like it's far and above the workforce goals, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. But I think that Representative Draskowski made some points that we want to, in addition to making sure that we meet these workforce goals, that we're also making sure that we're doing it in the most efficient way possible. And so I'm just, if you could just answer, is that number above the actual required by the workforce goals? And if you could just comment further on the article, perhaps.
Ms. Helgen.
Yeah, I understand. I know you're in a hurry. Mr. Chair, Representative Pepin, there are two separate things. One is the targeted business goals, which are used for the number of subcontractors, and then there's the actual workforce, people that are hired for the construction project. The targeted business goals for the architect were essentially 19%, and they met those goals. The workforce goals are higher for the construction project, 32%. And again, those, all of those goals are required by legislation.
Representative Pepin.
Yeah, I know. I'm sorry, Mr. Chair. I know you're trying to move on, but this is important. Thank you for answering that. So we have far and exceeded those goals so today. I mean, it's above 32%.
No.
Representative Ms. Elkin.
Yeah, excuse me. Chair, Representative Pepin. The targeted business goals that we had for the architect were 19%. We have not far exceeded those goals. I do believe some of the subcontracts are not finalized. So we haven't said 100% sure that they've met those goals, but they believe that they are on track to meet those goals, not to exceed them in any significant way. But as you might guess, if you're trying to hit 19%, you might end up at 19 or 20 or something like that. But it should be right at what the goal that was set required.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. Is there any more questions? If not, thank you for coming.
Thank you very much, and I'll be available anytime.
We'll probably have more questions later. Probably have you back later on. And the next thing on our agenda is State Auditor Rebecca Otto is going to give a presentation. And I apologize for the lack of the shortness of time.
Mr. Chair, members, Rebecca Otto, the State Auditor, so pleased to be with all of you today for a very brief presentation, an overview of the office and what we do. Here's my, maybe a promise to you, I'm going to try really hard to keep this short, sweet, interesting and informative, and maybe even entertaining. All right, I'm going to move over to this microphone. All right, the State Auditor, oops. No, that's not what I wanted to do. Here we go. It's a constitutional office, and there's a staff of about 110. Here's the main thing we do. We oversee $20 billion in spending per year by over 3,000 local governments in Minnesota. And I tried to break it down into some simple statements. We do it by auditing, investigating, reviewing, certifying, reporting, and educating. So now what I've done is I've tried to make it really simple. Here's what we do. Show me the money. So taxpayers want to make sure there's accountability and transparency in that $20 billion, and so we help show them the money. One really important thing to understand about our office is we're the only entity that collects, reviews, and maintains long-term comparable financial data on these over 3,000 units of local government. Who uses this data? Taxpayers, the legislature, and the researchers use our data, governor, media, other researchers, state agencies like Department of Revenue, and more. So it all comes from our office. And for the taxpayers, it provides that transparency and accountability, which is so important. I wanted to show you a quick screenshot of the website. Show me the money. Let's just say, Mr. Chair, that you were interested to see what your city, what the revenues, expenditures, and capital outlay was for 2010. So you'd go to reports and data, and you'd select comparison tools. And on that page, you'll see a link for towns, cities, and counties. So let's say that we go to Brooklyn Park. That is where you live, correct, Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so Brooklyn Park, 2010. What you would see, this is just part of the page. I'll show you the rest of it. This is the revenues for 2010. And you can see it's Hennepin County, population just about 76,000. And there's lots of information on the different sources of revenues that Brooklyn Park has, as well as here's their expenditures for 2010. And you'll see per capita, and then as well as a rank. Now, you all are over 2,500. You're grouped with Minneapolis, St. Paul, Duluth, Rochester, some of those larger cities. And there are your capital outlay expenditures. Now, let's just say, Mr. Chair, that you said, but what did they do in 2009? What you can do with our tool, because I don't think many of you are interested in going to giant spreadsheets on lots of financial data. Some folks are. But this is a nice way for taxpayers, the media, or lawmakers to pull up distinct information about a particular community. So this is 9 compared to 10. But you could also pull up another city if you had a comparable city. Finally, I'm trying to keep this interesting and short and sweet. On that reports and data tab, if we have data on our counties, on municipal liquor stores, if that's an area of interest to you. If you serve on a committee that deals with crime, we have the criminal forfeiture report that we issue annually on how law enforcement is using our criminal forfeiture laws. Follow the money. So we follow the money. The way our oversight system works is pretty darn efficient. We tend to be better in Minnesota. So local officials in Minnesota, we have lots of eyes and ears. Local officials are required to report to the office if they have any evidence of misuse of public funds or assets, which really helps. So there are eyes and ears. As well, private CPA firms that audit many of the local governments by law are required to report if they find evidence of misuse of assets or public funds. And so that's another really important piece to our oversight. As well as taxpayers can also report to our office if they suspect that there's been misuse of public funds. Follow money. So what we do is, as an office, although we don't have enough staff and you wouldn't be able to fund enough staff to cover the whole state, we have a small, very efficient staff that uses the eyes and ears of others. When we conduct investigations, which we do, or we assist law enforcement in doing investigations or others, when we have a case, we do refer to the appropriate county attorney. And we also make sure to train our local officials to prevent and detect fraud, which is a good preventative measure. I wanted to show you the next page is a table of contents from a summary report of investigations done from 2007 to 2009. I'm just showing you that page so you can see the different kinds of entities we work with, restitution that was ordered. When we do these investigations, there typically is positive action within the courts. And there's an EDA, there's a fire relief, there's a county planning and zoning department, schools. So a variety of entities. Finally, for follow the money, if you want to see if any of your entities had the pleasure of working with our office, either with, you know, we have review letters and investigative letters under the investigation, special investigation reports tab. Give us the money is the next heading. So what we do is we certify eligible cities for state local government aid, LGA. It's an accountability measure to the state and the taxpayers. So they get the aid if they meet the requirements. Requirements would include their audit requirement and also completing our annual financial reporting form, which we then report out to all of you. It is an important source of revenue for many of our cities. By the way, you might notice some of your cities, you might see a fire truck or different things. I try to feature many lawmakers, communities. We certify volunteer fire relief associations for Fire State Aid, another state program. It's accountability to the state. They only get the aid if the requirements are met, which would include their audit requirement, their reporting requirement to us, as well as compliance with the laws. And when they pay out pension benefits, these are pensions. When they pay them out, if they have not followed the law, they have to get things fixed before they will get certified for their aid. This is really important to safeguard these over 700 pension funds and provide transparency as well as support the state's very cost-effective volunteer statewide firefighting system. Finally, community development. I can't remember which community this is from. This is Pheasant Crest Townhomes. And this project wouldn't have happened but for tax increment financing. The reason why these laws can work, and it helps development throughout our state, helps assist it because we oversee it. We make sure there's not abuse of the laws, that there's compliance with the law. We also work to make sure the districts, TIF districts, are decertified in a timely manner and taxable value is returned to the property tax base, as well as if there's any excess increments collected, they are returned to the property tax stream. Finally, audit the money. We do conduct annual financial compliance audits, including the single audit for the federal government or federal funds. Why do you need audited financial statements? It's one of the least sexy things that are done, but really a critical one. Because audited financial statements of our governments are used by bondholders, rating agencies, taxpayers, and more. So if your community wants to issue bonds, they have to have audited financial statements. And finally, the single audits are used by federal and state agencies and departments when they consider awarding grants and funds to your communities. So it's an important thing. Finally, oh my gosh, I'm doing it. Legislative initiatives. I told you it'd be short, sweet, and hopefully very informative. We have a handful of legislative initiatives this year that I believe will come before your committee, and I'm going to give you that one-minute summary. 609.456 reporting, that's where local officials have to report to us if they found evidence of misuse of funds. We'd like to add the volunteer fire relief officials to that, that requirement. They do not have a problem with it. We have an annual working group we convene. Just important to safeguard those pension funds. Our office houses an accounting system software for our cities and towns. If you have townships in your community, this is an important tool for them. So we just need to do an update and achieve through user fees in a special account. Job Z, and there's a new dairy council. I'd like to get those duties transferred to the OLA, the legislative auditor, because it's state government and we only do local government. So legislative auditor has no problem with that. I want to work on stabilization of audit rates for our counties and cities that we audit. Staff retention, just so my staff can continue to get this good work done. And then we also have our annual volunteer fire relief working group bill, which Mr. Chair, I believe, would come before your committee. There's some technical changes and to make sure that our volunteer system continues to work and that those folks can be in compliance with the law. And Mr. Chair, with that, I'm happy to take questions.
Okay. Representative Ruskowski, you had a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Auditor Otto. Last year we had a bill to allow counties to use local audits like our cities and schools do. I wasn't here, but I believe you testified against that. Why, especially our smaller counties, this is a huge burden to them. Why is it that counties specifically require your office to audit them rather than a local auditor similar to the schools and city?
Ms. Otto.
Mr. Chair, Representative Dostrowski, good question. The entities that we audit typically get a lot of state money, and so the way it was set up was counties that is basically an implementation branch of state government, and they get a lot of state funds. Cities of the first class get a lot of state funds as well, and so we audit them. Now, there is a process in place, and there are counties that are currently working with private firms. There's a three-year rotational program, which most counties understand now. I continue to communicate with them. And so some were released, and some were brought back. And I think the legislature initially intended that because I have to run for statewide election, if I'm not doing a good job, the voters can throw me out. But cost consideration, I wouldn't say there's a huge difference in cost. And we just did our annual, survey of counties, their audit costs, the timeliness of their audits, the quality of the audits, and 100% of them said their audits were on time. About half of the audit costs went up, half went down. The reasons why they go up typically, new federal funds, the stimulus funds, if they do a major bonding, if they bond for a project, all those things require auditors to do additional testing. But currently there is a program in place that allows them to rotate in and out.
Representative Ruskowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, Auditor Otto, I would say that in talking with local government officials, they do know what their costs are and they communicate that to me. And suggest that it would be much cheaper for them to go forward and audit on their own. And they generally are not happy with the flexibility that your office has given them. And I don't know what we can do to improve that other than change the law and allow them that. Anyway, those are editorial comments. Thank you for coming today.
And Mr. Chair.
Auditor Otto.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Representative Dostrowski, if you wanted to talk to me offline, if there's any counties you'd like me to communicate with or we work with them, too, to help them understand how they can reduce their audit costs because there are things that are in their control. I'd be really happy to engage with any of your communities if any of them are concerned.
Any further questions? Representative Quam, did you have a question? Okay. Representative Quam, have you looked at the minutes?
I have reviewed January 16th minutes and would like to move to approve.
Motion to approve the minutes from the January 16th meeting. All in favor? Any questions? All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Minutes are approved. And thank you, Auditor Otto.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
And we will have further questions in the future as they come up. Thank you. And with that, anything else needs to come before the committee? If not, we're adjourned.